name's Sophie and I am the Historic Environment Officer for the Tay Landscape Partnership, which is one of these large heritage lottery funded partnerships, and it's being delivered by Perth and Kinross Heritage Trust and Perth and Kinross Countryside Trust. And you can see our various funders along the bottom, and we have lots of support from local community groups, residents and schools and the council as well. So the Hillforts project sits within a whole suite of heritage projects that I have been tasked with delivering, along with help from lots of other partners. So I thought I'd give you a little insight into some of the other projects that I'm doing, just as a flavour of the TLP. So first off, we have the top right here. I'm going to try the laser pointer. Yep, that's all right. We have Vertebrate Pictish Stones project, and that involves taking, we've basically had the Invermay cross fragments and Vertebrate cross A and B. We've had the fragments cleaned and mounted, and they are now on display as part of the SERF exhibition, the Cradle of Scotland exhibition at the Hunterian. And you can see that exhibition until the new year, when it will be coming to Perth Museum, and then eventually we'll be putting the stones back into Vertebrate Church. How is the volume for everybody? Is it okay? Good? Okay. Another strand we have is looking at Kinfonn's Old Parish Church. The next photo here, you can see we've got Headland Archaeology doing some historic building recording work for us, and they also did a programme of test fitting, and that's before we actually get started on repairing this medieval church in spring next year. So that's quite a big programme of works, part funded by Historic Environment Scotland. Another very big strand of the Tayland Landscape Partnership and its celebration of heritage is looking at the really important vernacular clay building heritage of the area. And you can see here this mud wall, this is Horn Farm, and last year we actually completely repaired this mud wall, and this collapse here has just been caused by bad rainwater use and not being maintained properly. So we've got a whole programme of works in and around repair. If anyone lives in Errol in a mud building, we're about to launch a grant scheme as well, so do get in contact. Onto one of our other important areas is Abernethy, and this is one of our first test pits that we excavated as part of the Wee Big Dig, which was fantastic. We had a really good time working with the Museum of Abernethy to deliver our first weekend of excavation. Other projects include field walking. We've been out field walking in the Carse of Gowrie, where we found almost 90 lithics of various types and forms. And heritage outreach events as well. We've been out, we had a fair called Unearth the Mystery of Prehistory in August this year, and this is a couple of the guys talking about Iron Age life, I think. So where did the Hillforts project come from? I mean, the Tay Landscape Partnership's made up of ideas and projects that both the Countryside Trust and the Heritage Trust have wanted to deliver for quite a long time, but had never kind of had the funding, had found a way to do it. The Tay Landscape Partnership funding package kind of allows all of these projects to happen. So the Hillforts project is very much the brainchild of David Strachan, who most of you know as the county archaeologist in Perth and Kinross. And the area has lots of early excavations of Hillforts in our area, which is fantastic. And also the amazing work of Tessa Poller and the team in the SERF project for the last decade. So from that, the Hillforts of the Tay project kind of became the next step, if you like. So looking at the SERF excavated sites so far, you have all the ones that SERF have excavated in green, and this slide is thanks to Tessa. And then up here, the sites that I'm going to talk about is Moncreiffe Hillfort, and next to it is Mordun Top, also known as Karnak, locally. So this slide just gives you another kind of location map of the site. My main focus of this talk will be to look at the results of two seasons of excavation at Moncreiffe Hillfort. We were there in September 2014 and in April this year. And you can see the site just sits up here. You see it when you're coming up the motorway on the sort of southwest of the hill, and it overlooks the Bridge of Erin and that sort of viewpoint down there. So we have lots of important prehistoric settlement in the area. The slide shows some of the main defended sites that we have. All along the south here, we have Abernethy Wall, and then we have Duke and Wood, other hill forts, Evelet and things to the north. and 4 and 5 are the hillforts that we are looking at through the Tay Landscape Partnership. So yeah, so early work, I mentioned there was early studies of the hillforts. Christensen looked at a lot of the sites in the area, as you all mostly know. And he actually visited Moncreiffe Hillfort and found that it was scarcely recognisable to him as a fort, which kind of gives you an indication of how little could be seen on the ground. And in addition to this, studies since Christensen in the 1890s, the NMRS went out to visit the site in the 1950s, I think, and they found scarce remains of Moncreiffe Hillfort. And again, we asked the Commission to undertake an interpretive survey of Moncreiffe Hillfort for us, and they felt that it was barely anything visible to record, so they didn't go ahead with that in the end. To support this, the geophys, both resistivity and magnetometry, were fairly inconclusive. The magnetic reading was high, probably because it's a big bit of volcanic rock, and yeah, the rest of it didn't really prove any evidence of any human action or activity. So this is just a slide to show you our trench location. The red trenches are the first phase of works. The first phase was very much trying to confirm presence or absence of hillfort. That was obviously a very important thing for us to do. And after we confirmed a presence of a hillfort, we came back and extended some of our trenches to kind of take in the outer works. So trench one is looking at the rampart on the northwest side of the site. Trench two, looking at the rampart on the east side of sites. Trench three was kind of looking just down here it was almost like a bank of material that we didn't know whether it was a modern bank or indeed a continuation of the rampart. Trench four was placed over a possible entrance to the hillfort, and with trench five, we wanted to have a look at this feature to see whether it was a hut platform or whether there was some sort of interior building in the fort. So I'm just going to run through the trenches and what we found. Trench one, if you'll remember, was the one that was over a section of rampart. In the top of the trench, we found a dry stone faced rampart with an earth and stone core. That's what the picture on this side kind of shows. The wall faces down here. And in our second phase of excavation this year, as we extended the trench, we actually found three earthen ramparts on the outer periphery of the fort. So the site is already a lot bigger than we thought it was. Trench two, again, that was looking at a section of rampart on the east side of the fort. You can see we've got some rubble core makeup, and then at the edge of slope here is actually where another dry stone faced bit of wall was. Our extension trench identified another two earthen ramparts and a section of cut bedrock, really quite impressive section of cut bedrock in the middle of this, which you can see here. And we think that the bedrock part of this trench actually relates to the middle earthen rampart round where we found that we found in trench one. So kind of a mixed approach to how the build come about. So this just showed you quite clearly those features. You've got your stone rampart on the top, kind of top of slope, dry stone faced. We're unsure of how the level of preservation of this is really not very good. So we're unsure of how much of it actually survives around here. And you can see quite clearly the three outer works now identified through our excavation. Trench three, that was the trench that was located, I don't know how many of you walk up Moncreiffe Hill, there's lots of dog walkers and stuff, but as you go onto the site, trench three is basically just off the path. And what we discovered was that the bank of material was actually upcast from the modern path, and underneath it we had this really interesting rock cut ditch section, if you like, and inside lots of occupation material, including the stone, which looks like paving, but it's actually a stone that's just, I think it's been laid and it's cracked in situ. We found several finds and things in this deposit too, so it's likely that this is part of the internal interior of the fort as opposed to anything connected to the rampart. Trench 4 doesn't look like much actually when it's a picture like that on the slide, but you've got kind of pecked out bits of bedrock. We did confirm this was a possible entranceway onto site, and there were two phases of activity actually. There was a wall that had been rebuilt as part of that. So artefacts, I think we found about 36 artefacts at Moncreiffe Hillfort with our two seasons of excavation. The best of those were a gaming piece that we found in trench 3, in amongst all that kind of nice charcoal-rich occupation material, and a nice piece of quern and a nice piece of possible shell, a shell bead. So this is our radiocarbon dates for that hill fort. Interestingly, we've got two phases of activity on the hill identified through our carbon dates. We had a mid-Neolithic date, which we actually found a few arrowheads and stuff that, as we were excavating downslope from our ramparts in phase two, so it would be good when we get those looked at. And we also have a very strong Iron Age date. We don't have any early historic activity on this site. So I'll go on to our second hill fort, which is a much larger, much more complicated structure on the same hill, and it commands a much better view of both the Tay and the Erne. You can see all the way to Dundee from where we're on top. It's an incredible place. So here is its location, and on the right here you can see our trench plan on the Royal Commission's survey that they did for us. So this survey was a huge, hugely important for us in planning and trying to understand the site a bit more before we started excavating it. So John Sheriff and George Geddes and another couple of Royal Commission guys came out and they spent an entire week looking at Mordantop for us and came up with a sort of semi-phased, provisional phasing for the site, which it should work. So this was identified as the earliest part of the fort, with this kind of unusual mound, which had kind of been ignored in previous plans and maps of the hill fort. A second fort, which kind of cuts around the back of our unusual mound. And then we have an annex at the top of site and this top fort citadel with, you can see the kind of hut circles, enclosures. But it's also worth pointing out the level of quarrying and kind of digging out of all the stone. And there's actually some documentary evidence that ties people coming up and taking away big bits of stone and using them to rebuild down the hill. So it would be nice if some of the hill fort is in Bridge of Erne, but I'm not entirely sure about that. And it's also worth just pointing out that this track, this is a sort of main way to access the hill fort when you're walking up on site. That's possibly a 19th century sort of carriageway that comes right up into sight. So the ladies and lords would have had a nice cup of tea and enjoyed the view. So the geofence was much more conclusive for Mordantop. You can clearly see this is where the big fort, the later fort, is at the top of the hill, and then the correlates really nicely with the Royal Commission's plan. So I'm just going to give you a really quick rundown of our findings. This is all, we were excavating here just in September, so it's kind of hot off the press. So interpretations will change. We don't have any radiocarbon dates for the site yet. And this is very much what we found. And yeah, just to give you a little insight. So trench one was placed on top of the mound, and it kind of came down the south side of that unusual mound that I pointed out earlier. And you can see here we've got some really nice cut bedrock, almost terraced, and tool marks on the site. And I don't know how well you can see it, but that's a piece of dry stone wall as well. And we had a nice course of red sandstone. So the majority of the stone we find on the site is local stone, but the red sandstone was something a little bit unusual, and there was too much of it just to be an erratic. So there's some enthusiastic volunteers, some which may be in the room, I'm not going to say, in amongst this kind of occupation debris that kind of tumbled or come to the bottom of that slope. It's important to remember that in this area, we're actually inside one of the forts. So this is an aerial view of that trench. You can see the wall running here. We have this really large section of wall core. And we think that there's the interface of the wall is actually in here. It's just been really badly demolished, or whatever's happened to the structure post-use, it's not survived particularly well. And you can see the terrace rock cutting all the way down that hill too. Interestingly, in the internal section of this trench, of this feature, which we think is a circular feature that goes all the way around the top of the mound, think we found lots of burnt earth and turf and kind of layers of burning and charcoal and things. So whether a turf roof has collapsed and burnt as part of the process, we don't know. But we're really excited about the dates because we were banding around ideas of whether we had a broch possibly here, which might be a bit controversial for some folk, or whether we've got a big monumental roundhouse. I mean, there are only two other known brochs in Perthic and Ross. There's the one that Tessa excavated at Castle Craig, and then there's the other on King's Seat, just next to Dunsin and Hillfort. So that's a keep your eyes peeled to keep your ears posted type part of our site. So onto our other trenches. It's worth mentioning that our trenches on Moncreiffe Hillfort were roughly 2 meters by about 10 to 20 meters. But when we came to Mordun, we realized that we'd have to really upsize our trenches. So trench two, which covers both the first and the second possible fort rampart, is actually 4 meters by 30 meters. So we found quite well-preserved dry stone-faced ramparts in both, and there are a possible ditch-type feature down here as well. And it just shows you a nice aerial view of the site and the kind of level of preservation that we had. The blocks of stone were pretty impressive. It was really, really nice site. Trench 3, this was the happy trench because it was fueled by lots of sugar because lots of people were bringing lots of biscuits to this trench, which was good. And that's some of our happy volunteers having revealed this really interesting part of wall. Trench 3 was positioned over the annex as you're coming up onto site, and you can see the wall is built right onto the bedrock here. And again, there's some pieces of red sandstone coursing in that as well. Trench 4 was quite a surprising discovery when we got to it, because when we first started peeling off the turf, this is the trench that's on the top fort, so the latest citadel fort right up at the cairn when you go and visit. We came onto really compacted kind of nasty stone here, and everybody was troweling away, and then all of a sudden all of this rubble just appeared. And the size of the blocks on this part of the trench were colossal in comparison to the other stones that were used for face walls elsewhere. And it's estimated that the piece of wall here is about 5 meters in width and could have been 5 to 6 meters high, or maybe even more, with the amount of demolition material we got out. So quite impressive. So that's really a synopsis of the Hillfort. We've got a lot of questions to answer. One of the main questions are how the two Hillforts relate to one another. Moncreiffe Hillfort has a solely Iron Age kind of date. So how does Mordun Top relate to it? Do we have a period of activity when they're both being used at the same time? Or do we have a movement from one Hillfort up to Mordun Top for a more advantageous position, or maybe a change in power or systems? So I just wanted to talk a little bit about our outreach and education as part of the Hillfort. I don't know how many of you are gamers or into computer games or have kids or grandkids who might be interested, but you can download a 2-scale Mordun Top Hillfort. You can excavate it in Minecraft, and you can download a reconstruction of it in Minecraft. So if you have kids that are possibly interested in archaeology, it's a really nice little tool for exploring archaeology in a very different way. And I just want to say thank you to all of our volunteers. We've had over 4,000 hours logged with volunteers just on our Hillforts project alone. And these are some of the walls that I think we spoke about a lot when we were on site. So I'd just like to say thank you to everybody for your help, because it's much appreciated. Thanks.